Welcome to the August 17th, 1993 Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting. First order of business this evening is to review and pass on the minutes of the previous meeting. Any discussion? Or do I have a motion first? Doesn't matter. Judy?
Just one comment on the last page, page 5, fourth paragraph. There's a paragraph dealing with something I said, and this is would minimally clear up it, and I would like to offer the following sentence. Ms. Lardner said she was particularly interested in whether increasing the usage of a home versus increasing the impervious surface would indicate perhaps not much of an impact in the first case. Thought that might help.
I put that in brackets with a question mark because I didn't understand what the sentence meant, the way it was written. Do you need to have a reread that? Okay. Any other changes, corrections? I would just add on page 2, just below halfway down, it said Mr. Etzel open a public hearing. It's just a technicality, but I think at the end of it should state that the meeting was the hearing was closed. I'm sorry, page 2. Just add on that the hearing was closed. Do I hear a motion pertaining to the minutes or any other corrections?
Move to approve the minutes as corrected.
It's been moved to approve as corrected. Any other? Do I hear a second? It's seconded by Ms. Lardner. Any other discussion? All in favor of the motion, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Thank you. Before I get to the correspondence, draw everybody's attention to the tentative planning board schedule. We have a workshop upcoming on the 7th. Riverside Cemetery Master Plan School Building Project and technical amendments, probably one last pass if we don't finish those. Tonight. Maureen, what's the status of the school building project? Why is that coming back to us at this point?
They had requested to come back to the board for the August workshop and then moved it back to September. I think they just want to get the board up to speed on some of the most recent changes. I would like to let you know that I spoke with the superintendent yesterday, and there's no intention to try to get to the planning board before the referendum in November. So. There will not be any request by the planning board to review the project prior to the vote.
Good. Takes a little pressure off. Correspondence. I did get it out of order. Lincoln Institute land policy. Yes, Tom.
I'd like to comment on that. I don't know if it deserves a comment, but this process requires that the project be pretty well conceived by the time it goes to the voters, because the budget is established at that time. And at least in my experience, normally there's been a meeting with the planning board just to identify any concerns that might create budget issues related to the project. And I'm aware that there's been a change in the circulation patterns related to what we saw initially with the school. Is anyone in the planning board interested in seeing the project prior to November?
I certainly am interested in seeing it prior to that time. What I was afraid of when I saw the time frame come about is that the school board would be before this board. Pressuring us to make some decision before the vote.
Mm-hmm. You mean relative to approving the project?
That's right. Mm-hmm. Perhaps we can, Maureen can communicate to that. Will they have, by our September 7th meeting, anything refined further on the budget?
I have asked them whether they have enough of a substance to the plan to show the board again, and they feel that by the 7th they will have. I would like to remind the board, though, that the workshop agenda is set by you, and if you want to wait until some other date to review this, you certainly can do that. The workshop is supposed to be an informal meeting. There's no requirement by the people who are coming before you to submit plans or applications or pay any kind of a fee.
Any other comment, Tom? Any other board members? Okay, the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy Forum. Did everybody get a copy of this? Okay, I guess if there's any interest there, make sure you speak to Maureen. Is that correct? Or not necessarily so.
That particular forum is an application for a scholarship, mm-hmm. and it would provide whatever planning board receives scholarships with 12 different workshops, but the whole board has to commit to it, and you have to send at least one board member per workshop. So this might be something the board would want to talk about in the future, and if there's enough interest, I'd be willing to send in the paperwork.
Okay, I wasn't aware that it required the entire, I knew that it was a rotating, revolving board member participation, but...
Mr. Chair,
yes, Judy.
It indicates that we'd have to apply by August 20th if there was interest. I don't know if that's hard and fast. I was interested in that, but it indicates it was targeted for communities without professional planners, and I didn't know if that would make us ineligible.
I think since they sent it to us anyway, that it is targeted to communities without planners, but it doesn't preclude planning board members that do have some professional staff. And if there is interest, I can, you know, pursue the whole deadline issue, but.
Okay. Next is an article from the Maine Bar Journal by Chris Vaniotis, who spoke as a, was one of the speakers at a seminar that Maureen and Judy and I attended. I asked, when I read through this article, I think this is a good article to keep. There's some good legal tidbits in there. And I asked Maureen to take a look at if any of these issues apply to some of our technical amendments as they apply to phasing. I can see how there could be a catch-22 in there. Next, a copy of a newspaper article on septic system code revisions stir controversy. I was all ready to speak long and hard on this article, and then I decided it wouldn't be a good evening to start off on that, so for what it's worth. Did everybody get a copy of that? Environmental development and development brochure. A letter to Maureen O'Meara from Peter O'Malia. For an extension, please be advised we once again request an extension. The Cape Elizabeth 1989 tree survey, I got this late enough. I did not get to this interesting tidbit of reading. Hopefully along with the next item, which is the 1993 comprehensive plan. Hopefully everybody, did everybody get a copy of theirs? Did everybody read it yet? Ooh, all right, you went surprised. At least it's bound in one piece, and I can hopefully keep track of it. Also, the tree survey, a copy of the executive director's report from the Greater Portland Council of Governments, in which there's an article announcing that the new COG president is Janet McLaughlin from here in Cape Elizabeth. Any other items of correspondence or of note? None appearing. We'll go on to new business. The first order of new business this evening is the pool public access waiver request by Parker Pool for public access waivers for two new lots located off Old Ocean House Road, R2-14, public access waiver section 19-4-2B. We can have the applicant or a member of the applicant come to the podium, introduce yourself, and I guess at this point, this is a request for public access waiver. If you just could tell us in summary what you're proposing to do.
My name is Parker Poole, Jr., Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We're asking for a public access waiver at the property located at 442 Old Ocean House Road. What we want to do is to convey to our family members lots number one and two, as shown on the map that you have, dated July 2nd, 1993. We would request to be exempt from subdivision review because of this request for the waiver. And I've submitted on the letter dated July 12th, 93, many different things that are involved in this request. One thing I'd like to say that the map of the entire property located at 442 Old Ocean House Road, Cape Elizabeth, the owner of the property is Victoria S. Poole. I don't know quite what to say right now, other than you throw some questions at me. I'll try to answer them. We have a map here. I can point out, as you can see on your map, where the property is located. We have the rights of way and turnarounds and all the different things that are requested by the planning department, planning board.
I guess since the process with public access waiver is fairly open and sort of evolves as we approach each one, and we do handle a lot of public access waiver requests. I will throw it open to board questions. We typically just start with questions and get on to some specifics. There may be more issues that we're looking for. I guess I'll open it up to the board at this time for questions or comments. Judy?
I'm a little bit confused on this. I think primarily because it looks like this plan has served many purposes over the years, and there's a lot of conveyances indicated on here, so please bear with my confusion. After you subdivide Lot 1 and Lot 2 on the ocean, how many separate parcels will remain to Victoria S. Poole?
One. That's the remainder of the land.
Can you kind of outline it with your finger, and I'll try to follow it here?
The land is up here. I'll give you the outline showing the whole property. Comes right around here, down, and down to the ocean, across, and then the line comes up and over to this line here, and then goes straight up that driveway right up to Old Ocean House. No, wait a minute. It goes right up to Old Ocean House Road, and then back to the north, to where it begins. Now, within that property, we have a two-acre lot, which is called Lot Number 1, right here. We have Lot Number 2, which is down on the ocean, which consists of approximately 4 acres. These two lots we're trying to convey to our family members. Victoria Poole will keep the rest of the land as the other lot, if you want to call it that. Does that explain it?
Is Lot 1 actually kind of an island in her holding?
No. It's just a piece of land that was in it, and all we did was have it surveyed to carve out a two-acre piece. By an island, what do you mean?
Well, does the remaining parcel kind of jog around it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you follow the map, you can see Lot 1, and we've left the footprint. As you can see it, there'll be a house built within it.
Mm-hmm.
This is just conveying land and buildings that are all, the four-acre piece. Land and buildings which are already there.
Is the primary residence of the entire parcel the long one that's marked house?
Yes.
Just to the north of Lot 1?
That's correct, up here, right? That's where we live, right there, okay?
Okay, I guess my major kind of a technical question is when I was going over, I guess it would be the easement deed to Victoria Poole. It talks about an easement from Old Ocean House Road to the bridge.
Yeah, okay.
But it looked to me like Lot 1 would be accessed further along.
No, but we're accessing it because the right-of-way comes down the road and then bears over to the left.
Yes.
And then this butts right into the two-acre lot. This is all on our property here, and the easement right-of-way goes down here. The bridge is further down. Can I bring this out, so you have a map?
I have a map. I guess I was confused because Lot 1 shows an apparent drive right into the south side near the test pits. Is that something existing right now?
What do you mean apparent drive? I don't understand.
There's the existing private road that looks like it pretty much runs straight east to the ocean.
Well, it comes up here.
I think she's referring to one that runs right straight, just south, well, just below Lot 1, and it shows a dotted spur of a driveway into where the test pits.
What? Over here?
That's the path through the woods.
Oh, is that what you're talking about?
I think we're going to spend a little bit of time trying to get oriented on this.
Okay,
which, you know, don't get discouraged. This is a little bit of a...
My wife come up.
Sure.
She's always got the...
I'm Victoria Poole, and I think, show me what she's talking about.
I'm happy to show you my mind.
Okay, Maureen, our planner at this point would like to just...
What I was looking at, down along here, and I saw bridge. The road
comes over here, so we come down.
So this is not access to your lot?
No.
Okay.
This is not important land over here.
Okay, but just since the house was here and a drive was going in there, that's what I assumed. Oh, okay.
The rest of us, Judy, that's not the access.
Okay, Maureen, I think has a comment.
If you look on your plans, the access point, as it comes off of Old Ocean House Road, it veers off into a fork. Mm-hmm. And all of the land that is part of this review will have access off of the northern leg of that fork. Mm-hmm. The part of the land, the road that goes straight ahead, doesn't have any specific access requirements for this road, for this land. So you go down, and when you hit the fork, and the bridge is just beyond the fork,
yes.
You veer to the left, and that's where the access is for all of this development. What the applicant is proposed to do, because that link of land between Old Ocean House and the fork is on a different piece of property, the applicant does have a right-of-way, and the right-of-way states that they will continue to have a right-of-way as long as Poole's own the property. If for any reason that no longer is available to them, they have proposed a new connecting road, which is a little bit further north on Old Ocean House Road. That's intended to be constructed only at the discretion of the owner.
That would be my final comment, I guess, at this time, is I feel uncomfortable talking about approval with a note about construction of a road at the discretion of the owner at some future date, and I know we'll discuss that. But I guess that's it for now.
The two names, if I will, before somebody else starts, Rosamond Symes Richardson and Victoria Poole, both, is Rosamond still a co-owner of these parcels of land?
No. Victoria Poole owns the land I outlined on the mm-hmm. map. Rosamond Richardson owns the land to the south of it.
To the south of the road, both of those parcels?
Yeah.
Or the one that's in question as well? There's one that says probably...
No. No, she doesn't own this one up here. The one I outlined.
No.
We probably should have scratched that out. But this is an old map that they mm-hmm. keep working on.
Okay, let's go back to continue with some questions or comments from the board, other board members.
Through the chair, does the parcel across Old Ocean House Road also, is that included in the overall parcel?
No, that has nothing to do with this. That's not owned by us. The one over here. It's owned by our children.
Is it across Ocean House Road?
I said across from both.
Okay. And then to follow up on Judy's question, then access to Lot 1 would be from the north. The driveway would come from the access road.
Yeah, the access to Lot 1, down the road, and then going over to the left, and on down through the property, and it all abuts that right of way.
And this is in a marine use only zone, is it?
A what?
Just a little inside joke. I did some waterfront zoning in...
So am I.
Long, long time ago. That's all. Other comments, questions? Anything, Mark?
Could I just clear up one question? I noted the parcel immediately to the south, which on the plan says Rosamond Symes Richardson and Victoria Symes Poole, then that's only Rosamond Symes Richardson.
That's correct. Down here, okay, I just want to point it out, so this section in here.
Yes, it says Benami and Symes.
Rosamond Richardson, right. Rosamond Symes Richardson.
The 13.4 acre parcel.
Yeah, well, it's this one here, this whole lot.
Yeah.
That's correct. 13.4, that's correct.
Has the proposed road to be built at a later date, has that been reviewed in terms of the type of land and presence of wetlands or its suitability for building the road?
We're not in a wetlands area here.
Okay.
Ernie McVane stated that, so...
Thank you.
Not that we can be consistent with public access waivers because we seem to do different things, but this keeps bringing to mind the sleeper estate, which seemed much more straightforward to than this one. And we did have a public hearing, and I know there was a lot of neighbor comment on that, and we did take a site walk. And I didn't know if there was any interest in at least the latter. Just looking at this, I have no major concerns about it, but especially with this proposed road or right-of-way on here, I feel very uncomfortable not knowing this property at all and trying to make a decision. I don't know if anyone shares my concerns.
Simply because we're not required to have a public hearing does not mean that we may not. I mean, we're certainly open to have a public hearing if we wish. The last time we had a public access waiver in this area, we did take a site, have a site visit, site walk. I was thinking, I was trying to remember as you were saying that, there was a specific reason why, but I thought that had to do with the placement of a septic system in question on the triangular-shaped lot, but maybe I'm wrong there. There are issues that I see, and I guess I'll just ask two or three questions myself. In the area of the turnaround in lot 2 itself, this is an older map, and it shows sort of a circular drive with a lane through the middle of it, and this plan is proposing some type of a hammerhead, which has not been designed or detailed.
Can I show you this may clear up pictures with the town?
Mm-hmm.
Here's
okay.
An aerial shot of just where you're talking about. The turnaround down here.
Is that the cottage?
Yes. And you can see that in the wintertime, we plow these roads. That will be the next question. How wide is it in the winter? Well, we plow very wide, obviously, at the beginning because of the snow. And this is a shot from the sea all the way up to almost the bridge up here, up as you come into the property. Now, I've got some other photos if you'd like to see them. You might want to pass those around. They're numbered 1, 2, 3, and 4. One being from Orchard House Road looking into the property right here.
Mm-hmm.
Number 2 is further down, and you can almost trace it on the map. Number 3, and this is looking way down field to the cottage. I guess my point is that the property is all fields. It's wide open. We have the fire chief on the property, and he looked the whole thing over, and I think he will back me up on this, that he said everything was super as far as turnarounds. I mean, if that's the that's a problem.
Okay.
Because it's wide open, right? You could turn a seven-ton tank, and there's so much room. There's plenty of room, so.
Well, typically, if you, and also just as a reminder, so it's a matter of record, if you could speak from the podium. No, I appreciate you bringing the photos up, but.
I don't want to get in the wrong area.
I want to make sure they get, catch every word on tape for you. I guess there's one board number I'd like to, and I have a note here elsewhere, have some type of letter from the police chief and fire chief as to the sufficiency of the turnaround itself. Also, there's an acute angle turn just, I guess that's north of the tennis courts.
Right.
Has the fire chief had a chance to take a look at that turn at all as far as access to?
He rode from Ocean House to the sea and back again.
Okay.
And there's plenty, this, the way this looks, this is all wide open here, so there's plenty of room to.
Is it all paved in that area?
It's paved here, as it turns, it's paved, but there's wide open area to the left and to the right of that turn. I mean, there are no woods, there are no, it's just open. And it's all, as you know, and people, it's all ledge, I mean, there's an awful lot of ledge up there, but the mud is not a problem.
Okay. Maureen?
I just want to let you know that in light of the comments made by the town engineer, I did speak with the fire chief yesterday, showed him the engineer's comments. He said that he felt that we could take a common sense approach and that he didn't have any concerns about being able to get into this property. It's really fairly level, there aren't any very sharp turns, and it is all field, so he felt that he'd be able to get his truck in and out without too much trouble.
Yeah, I appreciate, and I certainly encourage a common sense approach. I simply would like to have something in writing from the fire chief stating that. Lastly, and a couple other board members have mentioned it, it states a proposed road, and I guess my first question is, what's the need for the proposed road?
For the very reason that if someday the property were sold or there wasn't a pool on the property, there would be a proposed road because the access here would not be available.
But my understanding is that the applicant doesn't own that parcel anyway.
Which parcel?
Where the road comes in?
We have a deeded right of way.
Right. Wouldn't that carry with that property?
No,
with
it
lot
doesn't.
One and two?
Excuse
with
me?
Lots 1 and 2?
Excuse me?
With lots 1 and 2 that we're looking at tonight for public access waiver, doesn't that that easement, the right of way easement, carry with those lots?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So that proposed road would be for the benefit of some other property?
Possibly. We wanted to put it in there as another way to get onto this property if something should happen to the right of way which exists today, okay?
Mm-hmm. I guess as one board member, I'm not in favor of approving a proposed road for the future unless there's some specific need for it. Number one, it physically creates another lot, not legally, but physically. Number two, we have a scenic road that people enjoy, and I think we need to think long and hard before we approve additional accesses to that road without a specific need. Not to say that if that need arose in the future because of transfer of the property, that certainly wouldn't look at it when we came back. Any other questions or comments? Judy?
I would just ask Maureen, I guess,
yeah.
If the...
Could we say something?
Let Ms. Ladner finish, please.
I was just going to say, if the Pools did want to come back or did want to build this proposed road, would they need to see us again anymore?
Just to put the road in, probably not, but probably the road would be part of additional subdivision of land. And if the land wasn't being subdivided and qualified for one of the exemptions, that would have to come back to the planning board. There would need to be some kind of a driveway permit from the public works director.
So whether we grant a public access waiver based on a map showing a right-of-way or not, it could be constructed if there were no additional lots created without them coming back to us.
As long as they get their driveway permit.
Okay, thank you.
Just a couple of questions and comments. First of all, in the front of the property along Old Ocean House, there's no buildings in that area at all.
We took one down about, when was it, 10 years ago?
'83.
'83, there was a building there, and that has been just demolished.
That is one of the loveliest views.
It is.
From anywhere. That's a beautiful setting in there. The other thing, I guess, is a question to the planner. If the property does not require subdivision, because it's conveyed to family members, is there any restrictions on the saleability of those lots to third parties within any time frame?
Within the past year, there have been some recent amendments to the state subdivision law regarding those exemptions, where previously you were allowed to convey lots to family members. The current statute says that you can convey a lot to a family member, but that it has to stay in the family for 5 years. So that if, for example, one of these lots were conveyed to a family member and the family member sold it to someone else within a 5-year period, that could generate subdivision review.
Okay. And what would that would include the entire parcel then?
Again, they're talking about two parcels both going to family members. If just one was going to be sold outside the family, I believe they'd still qualify for an exemption. It's if both of them were to go outside, or if they created other lots that went outside, then you'd have to start looking at whether or not you needed subdivision review.
Okay, thank you.
I think we could say that's very unlikely.
Just a note, in the HHE 200, which is a septic system form, it lists property owners Alex and Mark Sawyer. Are those the family members?
That's correct.
Okay.
They're in the room tonight.
Okay. Other questions or comments? And I'm sorry, I wanted to get back to you. You had a comment. The time is allowed.
No, I just, when they said about the proposed road, we had no intention of doing it, and they said that we would have to have.
Yeah, I think they said
we would have to have an island.
It would be a good thing to have that there for the future. Now, we weren't intending to do it, but we thought that would be, since we had the engineer draw it to. Draw it in and get the 50-foot right-of-way and have it all tied in with the whole system that we've got here. And it really, even though maybe one day somebody may have to come back to the planning board, at least it's there, and it certainly gives the board, it would seem to me, a much clearer picture of now and what might happen down the road. If for some reason everyone got in a plane accident and there weren't any more, there wouldn't be any more pools living there or something, you know, there's those way out things that could happen. But, sure. I mean, that's the reasoning.
Okay.
I know the reasoning's correct, but that's the way we reason.
It's not unusual to see spurs or the proposed roads. It's just when we do see them, there typically is some reason for that.
Well, I think that's the reason.
Specific need.
Because of the right of way here, and that's the reason we thought it was a good idea.
But the need is for property other than the two lots coming before us tonight.
No, not necessarily.
I didn't understand that then.
Well, I mean, there's no road there now, and there won't be until such time in the future as. It's there to be available to be put in.
I was talking about the easement, the right of way that exists now to lots 1 and 2.
Well, see, the easement
over the land.
So the easement comes down and then comes onto the land, which is this right of way here, which comes right by lot 1 down to lot 2, and that's. The only easement only goes down to the so-called bridge here. And the right-of-way is before you get to it. Before you get to that bridge, you hang a left, and then it comes right up here, and this proposed road will come in from Old Ocean House, just connecting into what we're seeing now is a 50-foot right-of-way coming down through the property to the ocean.
Any other questions or comments from the associates?
guess I have one question, Mr. Johnson. Included as part of our memo from the planner, we did have a motion of the, for the board to consider, and it talked about the travel, or the public access road and turnaround be a minimum of so many feet wide, and I haven't heard any real discussion on if there is a certain width that would be required. Maureen indicated that the fire chief did not have any concerns with the property, but...
That's an issue why I would like to have in writing that from the fire chief, and I'd like a note from the police chief as well, stating that, that their proposed 10 to 12 foot wide paved surfaces is sufficient for their access.
Did the fire chief, Maureen, speak specifically to the width he would want?
He didn't say a specific width. We usually range in the mid-teens. We have adjusted that for special circumstances. There are times when the fire chief has reduced the width when there's a wetlands crossing, if there is an opportunity to widen the road out after that one point. It depends a lot on the topography. He was not concerned about the width in this particular instance. The road is there already, and because it's such a level area, he said, you know, even if the truck were to go off the road at particular points, there wouldn't be a problem.
I think so, if you, for instance, the sleeper lot application, the road went down to 8 feet in one stretch, and we approved that. But I believe that we did have something in writing from the police chief, or the fire chief in that instance, that it was sufficient. That's all my comment was, that it should be in writing for the record. Without that, I'm one board member that wouldn't necessarily agree to that, you know, without town staff's approval. See some notes being taken. I'll ask Maureen, I think the setback issue of existing buildings is a zoning board issue. Was there any waiver of setback requirements? Does that create a setback, does our approvals create a setback violation?
I don't see that as an issue. I just raised it for the board so they would be aware of it, but it is not unusual in laying out new roads that existing buildings end up violating the existing setback requirements. For example, the farmhouse in the Highland subdivision, the side yard setback was shorter than what we normally have in putting in the new road off of Two Lights Road. So it was just something I raised just so you knew that it was happening.
Was that something that was taken into consideration by the zoning board?
The zoning board has not seen this. It is just a public access waiver request. If for some reason the applicant wanted to expand a building that has become too close to the road, then it might become a zoning board issue. Might.
Okay. I mention that because as a chair, sometimes I get comments from other board members, not planning board members, that we may step on the zoning board approval issues. If you don't think that that's a major concern, I certainly will let it go.
Can I make a comment?
Certainly.
You had a comment you wanted to make about the future and how we were trying to keep the property. And
yes, if you could, please. Thank you.
I lived all my 65 years at Cape Elizabeth, at least parts of the year. I think I took a year off when we got married, and I love it dearly. And as you all know, taxes have gone up extremely, and I want this land to stay. I'm on the land trust board, and I love the open land we have, and I want it to stay as open as it possibly can for the future. And I think my children feel the same way, and it would mean a lot. It a lot to me to know that the land was in the hands of my children, and that they would not be, that if we divide it up, we can keep the land, if we, you know, among ourselves, and if we don't, it would get too expensive for one person or for them to be faced with it all at once, and that's why we're doing this.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Steve, specifically, what's your concern with non-conformance? Is it the shoreline setback on the cottage?
No, I think it has to do with the buildings up, isn't it? I think it's north of lot one, it's marked garage,
and you just to the left of the
10-foot setback in there. Any other questions or comments?
Just one quick comment on the plan. I'm not sure if everyone caught this or not, but the proposed section of road, the note that goes along with it does say that this portion of proposed roadway to be approved at a later date and to be built at owner's discretion. So they're not asking for approval of that particular portion of the road tonight.
That's right.
Good point, Steven. I didn't read it that way. Any other questions or comments?
Well, does it then, is it implied that we're approving the delineation of this, what you referred to, Steve, as a lot, this 50-foot wide right-of-way, regardless of the road location within or not within that right-of-way?
The question that I have is, I'm not sure what, by approving this site plan that states a proposed road with meets and bounds, even though it says to be approved at a later date, I'm not sure what we're approving and why. I've got some inkling now the why, but I'm not sure about the true need of that. That's not the additional lot that I was saying was physically being, it's just south of that.
It creates another. There are many times when property owners come before a board and they're asked questions about what are you going to do here in the future or what are your plans. I guess at least what I like about this is they've demonstrated a concern, and very strange things can happen in this world with respects to rights of way and property ownership. And they've demonstrated a concern for some possible future need, and as a board member, I feel somewhat comfortable with their acknowledging this as a reality and subtracting out of all of their holdings the need to go to provide this 50-foot right-of-way. What I'm not comfortable with is, in fact, whether it's buildable within the town road standards, and secondly, what the impacts would be, but I don't think we'd know that without either engineering drawings or a site walk.
Judy?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Throw it out.
Okay, thank you.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Parker Pool for a public access waiver for two lots, R2-14, off of Old Ocean House Road be granted subject to the following conditions. One, that the traveled way of the public access road and turnaround be constructed or maintained at a width and configuration acceptable to the fire and police chiefs. Two, that the applicant or owner of the property return to the planning board prior to any development of a new road from Old Ocean House Road through the property so that the planning board and the town engineer can review the design of the proposed road to ensure it meets appropriate town standards. Three, that the terms and plans of this approval be incorporated into the deeds for the lots prior to conveyance or issuance of a building permit.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second? It's been moved and seconded. Other discussion? I just asked, Judy, could you read number two one more time for me? That's a new.
I said two, that the applicant or owner of the property return to the planning board prior to any development of a new road from Old Ocean House Road through the property so that the planning board and the town engineer can review the design of the proposed road to ensure it meets appropriate town standards.
Any other discussion, questions? It has been moved and seconded. All those in favor of the motion as it has been moved, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you very much for a good application. Sorry we had such a stumble over the complexity of the map. It looks getting, like it's getting more and more complex all the time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
After our map folding exercise here in Russellane, we'll get to the next. Phil should play music in between these to cover up the Russellane plans. Or Steve, you could just sing. Next order of business this evening is the Petrus Wetland Alteration Permit Public Access Waiver. Robert and Ruth Petrus are requesting a public access waiver and wetland alteration permit for a new lot to be created off Fowler Road, R6-26. Wetland alteration permit complete in this section 19-3-9, public access waiver 19-4-2B. I see a representative of the applicant, or the applicant is at the podium. If you could identify yourself and perhaps give us a brief summary of what your proposal is.
Yes, my name is Bob Petrus. I live at 231 Fowler Road. And what I'm proposing to do is create a second lot from the property that we currently own. The lot of access on Fowler Road. Encompass a building site here and also take in the remaining part of the property. I've asked Albert Frick and Albert Frick Associates to be with me tonight to answer any questions that you folks might have about the proposal.
Okay, I think before we go on to specific questions and so forth, because we're taking this both as a wetlands alteration permit and public access waivers, one article. Before we start discussion of the application, I think it's prudent and required that the board find the application complete first. So we'll go through that process and then we'll return to Mr. Frick for questions, if we get that far. Comments and questions on the, perhaps Maureen, if you could walk us down through the issues dealing with the completeness pertaining to the public, to the wetlands alteration permit.
As you stated, there's no finding of completeness necessary for a public access waiver, but there is one required under the ordinance for a wetlands alteration permit. A checklist is included as attachment two, and I'll just go through and summarize some of the things that the board may consider incomplete. Starting with A, the plan as submitted does not show the placement of proposed utilities such as water and electric for the proposed lot. I guess you would assume that the utilities would follow the path of the driveway, but they're just not shown on the plan right now. The plan also does not show possible wetland areas within 300 feet of the building site. I met with the code enforcement officer again this afternoon on this project, and we're continuing to find new wetlands. The problem that may affect the site, we're not certain, is that while it is or could easily be 250 feet away from the wetland that's shown to the rear of the lot, the other side of Fowler Road is Great Pond, and there is a wetland that surrounds Great Pond. Because Great Pond is rated as a wetland that has moderate to high value for wildlife, it has a mandatory 250-foot buffer around it, which cannot be reduced. And it may be that the buffer will extend across the road and affect the front part of this property. That was part of the shoreline zoning amendments that were adopted by the council in the middle of last year. So there really is a need for the applicant to provide some more delineation of wetlands on the other side of Fowler Road to determine that they're not within 250 feet of the Great Pond wetland. Continuing on with H, there's a question by the town engineer on the plan whether a drainage ditch is existing or proposed. on K, the applicant is showing a driveway that is 22 feet wide, which cuts through the RP2 wetland area, which is the reason for applying for the wetlands alteration permit. The town engineer feels that if the road is 22 feet wide, the actual area of alteration will be at least 28 feet wide because of at least 3-foot shoulders on each side. And so it may not, the plan right now may not depict the actual area that is going to be altered in the wetland and just the finished area. Finally, there is some concern about the plans in that the title block does not have the name of the applicant. It can sound like a very technical problem. Unfortunately, I do have a lot of people come into the office looking to look at these plans, and it's very confusing, especially after a period of time has gone by, about whether an applicant got this plan approved or whether it was some other applicant. So it is important that the title block reflect the current information. Are there any questions?
Just following up on the comment, Maureen, I think one of the issues there is that oftentimes a surveyor's map is simply used as a base map and new work is drafted on it, and it looks like what the new work is part of the original survey. And I think that'll show up in another application tonight, so it's very important, as Maureen has said, to make sure that's clear. I know that there was a lot of discussion recently about the issue of the setback situation. There's a house between the wetland edge that you're describing. I'm assuming that this excavated foundation hole now has a house?
The actual house that we built is right here. Okay. I've penciled it in. This was an excavated foundation hole originally. We used part of that hole for the house in the garage. This is the actual location of the house. And there are several houses across the road here.
So the existing house isn't necessarily where it says excavated foundation hole?
No. It's right over where it says Elmwood.
I guess the only other question I have is that there's no way possible of doing this without requesting a access waiver. You don't have enough frontage.
I don't believe so.
Any questions, comments pertaining to completeness?
If I might, the question of the town engineer about whether the drainage ditch was existing or proposed, it's an existing drainage ditch. I don't know how many years old it is, but it's been there for years.
Mr. Chairman, may I just
comment on one thing? Yes. Mr. Frey, if you could step to the podium, please. Although we're not in the discussion of the application right now, we're still in the completeness issue.
I just wanted to point out one comment. My name is Albert Frick. I'm a site evaluator and licensed soil scientist, and I helped prepare portions of this application. We did have Ernie McBain out to the site to review some of the issues with regards to setback to critical wetlands. And he pointed out the fact that there is Great Pond over here that has a critical wetland. Ernie's comment on the day on the site was that there's a drainage divide between the Great Pond and this, what's going on out here, so he wasn't particularly concerned with that issue at the time.
Other comments, questions on completeness? Judy?
I guess the one thing that I'm torn on completeness, because usually partial attempts to address the standards seem reasonable to me as long as they're addressed prior to final approval. But the first item, a detailed site plan, when the utilities and so forth are left off, I feel
somewhat uncomfortable calling it complete. I also realize that this is a fairly detailed plan, and I understand what's going on, so I don't know what any other board members feel about that or if they'd like to discuss that.
So your question is dealing with completeness, the requirement for utilities to be shown?
Yes, because the ordinance is very specific, saying that utilities, so forth, and other features within 300 feet structures be shown, and it's quite clear that the utilities are not shown.
Other comments? Any consensus from the board? Tom?
I guess with respect to completeness, it's a fairly small project, but it's one that's in a reasonably developed area. And thinking ahead, I would like to have a public hearing on the project. I would be willing, because of the size of the project, to essentially find it partially complete. That is to say that, in fact, it's not complete, but it would be acceptable to proceed to a public hearing if it is made complete by the submittal deadline for the public hearing. Essentially, it's incomplete, but I don't want that to hold up the process.
Mine, if it's found to be incomplete, does that mean that we cannot schedule a public hearing?
Of course it does.
I know what you're, instead of delaying one more month, holding that, we've been here before, as far as making sure that it's a complete application. And delaying an application for 30 days. Any other comments from other board members? I think if I could get some type of consensus from both voting and non-voting members on how you feel about that issue, whether we should proceed or, yeah, I understand what the holdup here, the catch is that if we actually say yes, this should be done to make it a complete application, we delay it 30 days, we have a bad reputation for that type of thing. At the same time, complete is complete, and the ordinance is quite clear what we request of applicants.
Steve? I guess I have to concur with Tom that it seems to me we should proceed to a public hearing, provided that all the incomplete things are completed by submission time for the public hearing.
I have problems with that general approach. Either it's complete or not complete. I guess I'm just really trying to determine what actually is missing according to the ordinance. For instance, another one of our requirements that is partially complete or incomplete is the location and flow, direction of existing water courses, ponds, and standing water. I think you could call the application complete on that. There is some indication of where the water's going. So waiver requests on the stormwater runoff and the wetland mapping, well, I guess on the stormwaters, the applicant has indicated that this is a minor disturbance and was not particularly affecting stormwater. Is that correct, Maureen? And on the wetland mapping, that the wetlands are based on soils and that they are more restrictive or conservative than mapping based on vegetation. Is that the claim in the application? What do you feel about that?
I think the issue here is, unfortunately, more of we didn't delineate one of the other wetlands. I don't have any evidence to suggest that the delineation of the wetland that was worked on is inaccurate. And usually the best way to figure that out is to go and walk the site. It's the main issue, I think, is becoming where the boundary of the Great Pond wetland is and how far it stretches towards this building site.
With respect to item K on our application completeness checklist, which is talking about the proposed draining, filling, grading, dredging, and vegetation removal, perhaps, I don't know if this would be Mr. Fricht who would answer this, is what in our package specifically addresses that standard. Did you deal with this, Mr. Frick?
Yes, we proposed a 20-foot wide road filling coming through that would entail 1,900 some odd square feet of filling. I think the reason for the P there, or partial, was the engineer's comment not taking into concern a 7-foot shoulder. That would add a minor amount. We were also open to perhaps some guidance from the board. We proposed a 22-foot wide right-of-way coming in, and we would be open to some guidance as opposed to whether or not the board would like to see that reduced, as it has suggested in some other cases, due to the width of filling within the RP2 zone that would require. But I believe that's why the partial is on that specification. We do show the crosshatch area going through the Swanton poorly drained, which is the RP2 wetland, its location and extent.
And is there something on here that indicates the amount of disturbance that you mentioned, the figure?
Yes, it's in the submittal application to you under on the letter of July 27th, 1993, under note 7, last paragraph.
Right there. Could you explain to the board where water lines and power telephone cable will be coming into the property?
Yes, it's most likely that the water line, power, and cable would follow the road access and the filling to the dwelling site. The utility, the subsurface wastewater disposal would be in this box as shown.
And would only the water line be underground and the other be above ground utilities? They would all be underground? This may be strange, but I would accept that as part of the public record and would not hold up the item based on utilities being incomplete.
Mark?
I feel the same way that Mr. Emery, in his original comment. And of the items which I feel need completion or clarification, the two which were just addressed, I believe, were the ones which need completion as opposed to just clarification. And I would repeat the what Judy just said.
Anything, Tom?
I really love this process because in order to be deemed complete or incomplete, we have to get into some review of the application.
I keep waiting to grab people and getting into the discussion of the
Mr. Tinsman is the only one I remember who can really make that line and make it very clear. The only other thing I don't see clearly noted on this plan, and I don't know if this is the plan that would be recorded or whether this is just for planning board purposes, but I don't see a clear indication of the owners of the property. I see the Shelley parcel. I don't see the applicant's name on the 87,500 square foot parcel. Or am I just missing that?
No, we just used the original plan that we got when we bought the property.
And indeed, without going through the material again, is the proposed parcel 87,500 square feet the one that would remain with your house on it?
Yes, it is. That would be this parcel right here.
Any other questions? Judy?
I'll propose a motion.
Sure. Thanks.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Richard Mailman for site plan review... Oops, I grabbed the wrong one. Excuse me. I don't want you anywhere. I just had it. I had notes on it.
And you thought we just made them up out of our head, didn't you?
I may have to surrender. I was just writing them.
Don't do that. I'll find them.
Oh, there it is. Pardon me. Try that again. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Robert and Ruth Petrus for a public access waiver and wetland alteration permit for a lot off of Fowler Road, lot R6-26, be deemed complete.
Is It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any other further discussion?
All right, I think it should be introduced into the record that we would require additional information. Is that part of the completeness motion, or is that...
No, it certainly can be just made a part of the written minutes of the meeting, that at the time of the motion, that the request that be made a part of the record, that additional information would be requested.
Do you have that list?
Any further discussion? Just to confuse things, don't it?
No, that's fine.
All those in favor of that motion, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. It's deemed complete. At this point in time, there are two things we can continue to discuss, ask questions. Before we finish, we need to schedule a public hearing and come to some decision whether we want to take a site walk on this parcel or not. And we typically, I will simply say, the largest majority of all wetlands alteration permits, we do schedule a site walk. I don't believe a requirement. No. Okay, I guess at this point in time, I'd like to just go for some discussion, give the applicant some feedback, ask questions, and give some direction from the board. Comments? Thomas?
One of my first questions would be, in terms of the final application, is what is planned for the rest of the property?
The rest of the property? Well, the lot that we're proposing to sell or to develop here would be this area here, which would effectively go back and encompass the rest of the property, which, and this is the wetlands back here. It's my understanding that that's not developable property. So that would go with this building site, and it would effectively eliminate any possibility for further development back here, as far as I can tell.
I don't mean to interrupt here, but along that line, it's difficult to tell where the wetland edge of the IRP1 goes after it hits that heavy bowl line of the Elmwood. Where does it continue on? Or I think it does not stop there. Do you see what I'm near the back line of the 875
line? It continues on along the heavy line through this area.
Okay, I guess, okay. Go ahead, Tom, I'm sorry to interrupt.
As I guess the board may realize by now, I'm not a real fan of public access waivers simply because of the unusual way in which it carves up property. And I guess this would be another example, that it would seem to me that this property would make some sense to divide it in half, unless there's other reasons for doing it. But I really think of that as more a substantive review for the public hearing, not an issue that I want to address in detail tonight. But if you would be prepared at the next meeting to respond to that question, that would be helpful.
Any other questions?
No, that's okay.
All. Other board members? Judy?
I guess just in a general way, I would expect, before you folks to come back, that you would address the many comments that the town engineer had. We talked about some issues here about having the utilities actually on the plan, the owner's name in the title block. I, as one board member, would also favor seeing that driveway reduced. If that's something, if you can talk to the fire chief or police chief, see if they would favor that. You'd get more of my favor on that if it were smaller, especially going through the wetland. And certainly provide a lot more details about the roadway construction, specifically going through the wetland. And clearly, you need to address this whole issue of the Great Pond wetland buffer. It seems to me there's a lot of comments right in the memo that need to be addressed.
I guess along those same lines, the issue of this driveway, this access being within 10 feet of a side boundary, I take it it was slid that way to alter the least amount of RP2. I think there's a balance there where you can disturb a similar amount of property by moving that eastward, I believe it is. East. And reducing the width of the paved surface. So we're looking at 20, I guess along the lines of what Judy mentioned, we just approved public access waiver with an average width of 10 to 12 feet. I'm not saying that that's a figure that we like, but this is an access to one lot. And if we, including the shoulders, to narrow it down significantly in the wetlands area and move it away from the boundary land. I know that that side boundary is all under the ownership of the applicant at this point in time, but there are reasons why the ordinance states specifically to keep it 10 feet away.
If I may just comment, and those are good points. One of the reasons we put it close to the proposed line is it maximizes the site distance. And Ruth and Bob did not have any objection that there's a garage here and their leach bed is quite mounded, so there's a natural berm and a buffer as far as noise and aesthetics. And that maximizes the site distance, but there's ample, very, very little change in distance if it was slid over, and it doesn't seem to affect it too much, so those are well taken.
I guess I'll go ahead with a couple more questions. Al, I think this would go to you. This RP2 area, it shows that the flow is, it looks like some type of watershed or flow heading west from that area into, heading west into the RP1. Does that also, is there any way of telling you whether that is like an overflow area when the RP1 area fills up with water, does it flow back toward the east, or?
No, this is a man-made drainage ditch.
Okay.
And it appears to have been dug to drain this limited area. There's no more flow coming into that area. So it will not flow back to the east. Its primarily flowage will be to the west, and at times of heavy rains when this area is surcharged.
I get the question that, coming from memory here, but I think in your writing it states that you use the word conservative as a way to describe the 12-inch, and I think I know what you're saying. I'm not sure that was the right word to use there, but I think what you're saying that is an ample culvert, not necessarily a conservative or... I guess I'd also look for comments from other board members as to the requirement for a turnaround, the actual, there's none showing here on the plan as it exists. It's a little bit of a tight spot to fit it in there, it appears. We typically do see the turnaround area delineated in some type of detail as to the turnaround in the driveway area.
One of the reasons, and I'm maybe looking for guidance here on that issue, is that this area is very gently sloping. There's no bedrock knobs or anything to restrict or confine the location of that turnaround. This will most likely be a custom-built home, and I'm not certain by designating a turnaround whether it's going to be in the perfect spot for the landscaping and the location of the house and things of this sort. I would like to perhaps propose addressing this by just putting a specification on the plan that the turnaround will be cited and approved by the fire chief at site plan.
Or of certain dimensions.
Of certain dimensions.
Other construction specifics.
To locate it, I think, is premature because this is just an approximate building window, and I'm not certain how that would fit in.
It isn't. It's a pretty tight window. Is there a reason for that? Being such a pretty small building window?
This is the area of the proposed leach bed. We have 20-foot setbacks to that, and then we have a setback to the critical wetland and then the sidelines, and it pretty much dictates that area. But at the scale of 1 inch to 40, that's a pretty big, would accommodate a fairly large building turnaround.
Okay. Other questions, Judy?
I would just ask if the other board members would agree to have perhaps the town planner talk to the fire chief or somebody and come up with a standard way to deal with this turnaround issue. I absolutely agree with Mr. Frick. I'd hate to see a turnaround drawn here when you have no idea what the house is going to be like. I hate those turnarounds anyway. I think they're usually pretty ugly. So if there could be some standard way we deal with this, if it is a standard note to say prior to construction, it'd be approved by the fire chief or something, I'd feel more comfortable. I don't know if that's acceptable, but if we could come up with something more standardized in our approach.
I think that's a good suggestion. It comes up each time, and sometimes we get something in writing, sometimes we don't. The last application that was before us was just sort of word of mouth, and I feel uncomfortable with that type of relationship.
Maybe there are certain times when a front lawn turnaround is acceptable. From a single-family home, it appears to be the only house left to be developed.
I think if that's so, then why do we have it as a requirement, as a turnaround? I don't want to get off the subject dealing with our ordinance, but there must be a reason why just open land around the structure is not sufficient, you know. Frick says there's no bedrock here, no nubs, to restrict. At the same time, that means that and if you look at the soils, the springtime, they're a little bit wet. Mm-hmm. You back a fire engine around there, you're going to have it sitting there for a while. Mark?
I believe the reason is that in wintertime, with snow bankings, the front lawn turnaround may not be possible for an emergency vehicle. And this seems to be an instance which I'm not sure can be handled as easily right now as in the future, when something which could be seen as a de minimis change could be accomplished perhaps under the things we've been talking about in workshop by the town planner, in that even though it's premature to show a turnaround, with the size that a turnaround takes up on the site would be the same no matter where it was shown, and it could be shown and then moved at a later date.
I agree, and then Mr. Frick was looking for that type of direction. I think if you could provide this board with the specifics and the size that it would be placed in that general area, in this instance, it may be sufficient. Other questions or comments?
I guess the only, how large is this building envelope that you've shown on the site plan? I don't have a scale with me. What is it, 40 by 80 or something like that? The actual proposed building site, dwelling site. Oh, great, here we go.
Oh, the proposed. 40 by 60 is probably, I don't have a scale, but.
40 by 60. Yeah. And it appears from the HHE 200 that the grade is sloping back toward the house site.
Yes, it's the grade on the HHE 200. Let me just grab that. It's roughly the ridge there. The grade is a very slight grade back to the house, yes.
The only reason I raise that question is that I've seen several, there are some very difficult lots in town that have been developed, and some off Spurwink and Route 77, and the septic systems have been placed, in some cases, adjacent to the roadway, and the houses are some distance away from the roadway. And I've seen developments out, actually not too far from your place in Gorham, where the front yard is the septic system, and then the house sits eloquently behind it, or beautifully behind that. Is there a possibility, what would happen in the case where the builder wanted to raise the house foundation, is it possible to slope the grade away from the house and create a swale between the septic system and the house, so it doesn't appear as though the septic system is dominating the front yard?
Yes, I think the way this would be developed is pretty much that approach, is that the proposed house here, the foundation would be elevated. It's a glacial till soil that requires site modification, and the leach bed needs to be 20 feet from the foundation, most likely to make it aesthetically pleasing. That grade will carry over to the foundation, and it'll actually be a reverse grade where you'll have the slope from the house and the surface water sloping away from it, then towards it.
There's no chance of reversing the house site and the septic system site?
No, the reason being is that this Elmwood Scary Association Map A is the area of the moderately well-drained soils that today are acceptable for a disposal system. The area where the house site is proposed is somewhat poorly. It's non-wetland, but it doesn't pass the standards for a first leach bed. And there isn't enough of a window on the, if you set the house 20 feet from a proposed leach bed, to keep it away from the RP2 zone that would be in the front.
Okay. Is there, this is right out of left field, but is there any opportunity for development that you would see for the balance of the parcel in light of the new proposed septic system standards to limiting factors that the state is looking for? I'm quite sure the town ordinances would not allow that, but otherwise at the state level, do you see any?
Not any additional windows. What it would do is open up the flexibility to this proposed lot, whereby your scenario would become possible. The Elmwood somewhat poorly would become a suitable site, and it would open flexibility for siting. But it would not increase the development potential of the total parcel.
I guess the only other comment I would have is that I would concur with the other board members to get the driveway as narrow as possible and keep the fire chief happy. I guess in one case, if he's got 12 feet to work with, maybe 12 feet would work in some instances here, particularly as you're crossing the wetland. And as far as I see, what we're really talking about here is a single-family house with a long driveway. That's the extent of my comments. Other comments, board members, questions? I have a quick question myself on this proposed septic area. It shows a limiting factor of 16 inches. And our ordinance says that the laundry, the gray water, system is designed as a separate septic system or septic area. You've designed it as the same part of just one more line of chambers in the same system. Why would you do that?
The reason being is that the Cape's ordinance for separating gray water and black waste are to go to another area, separate it substantially, requires a pump. And then, because you have to pitch the pipes away from the foundation, you either have to raise the house more and more to get adequate pitch, or propose a pump. And the further you get it away and have to pump over, you may need a pump for both the black waste and the gray water waste.
But you're saying to create another area for, and there's a reason why you create another area for gray waste.
Right.
Is that that separate area would be required to be pumped?
It could be required if you get further away from the proposed dwelling site.
Is there any area in the Elmwood Scary soil to the west?
Yes, that would be the area that you would want to, if you were going to expand it and make a bigger window for the leach bed, that mm-hmm. would be the only area to go. This area towards the east is providing an access way to get into it. Okay. And to the south, we have a setback concern to the RP2.
the building site would be here, so it would be...
There's a reason why they're separated, and I'm sure you know what it is. At the same time, I think I'd like to have something from, through our planner, from Ernie McVain, stating that he either agrees that that's an acceptable method and why. I guess I would say, in my limited knowledge of these septic systems, that it's not an acceptable plan to just simply add another row of chambers in that same system. I would ask also that the HHE 200, it says recommended our ordinance under separate laundry system. You've written in recommended. Our ordinance requires it. It's not recommended. I'd ask that be removed. Is there room for a second septic tank itself, where, the way you've got a plan? Is it set up typically in series? What your plan, yes. your sort of disclaimer states that somebody's going to put a garbage disposal in their home, that they must put two septic tanks in,
yes.
Which is advisable. The plan that you've presented here, is there room to do that?
Yes, there is. That's usually done. There's a 20-foot separation between the house and the leach bed. There's an 8-foot separation between the house and the septic tanks.
Mm-hmm.
So there's plenty of room to gang septic tanks in series parallel to the leach bed. That wouldn't be a problem.
Does that happen very often? Do you see people putting in two tanks?
More and more.
It's good.
It's the cheapest way to add prevention for a leach bed.
Any other questions from the board?
Is it clear that we want the current house configuration drawn on the plan?
If it's not, then it should be made clear. I think the notes, the town engineer's notes mention that. Are there any questions that you have? I would generally look at those notes, and unless we've stated that we wouldn't require those changes.
Those notes were well received, and,
okay.
And they will be done.
Was it clear about the dealing with the narrowing of the paved surface itself, including the bevel shoulders, to fit into the 22 feet, but that requires a narrower paved area?
Yes.
Okay. Any other comments from the board? I just want to make sure that we're all of the direction that we can give the applicant, we get out at this meeting. Maureen, it's probably taking a look at this as far as any culvert required at the road itself. There's none proposed.
He hasn't made any comment to me that he wanted one.
Okay. It's tough to tell. Without looking at the site, it looks like there's maybe a 2-foot drop in the road there in that area, but back away from the road, it doesn't appear to be much of a grade change. Any other comments? If none, do I hear a motion? Does it fail,
Mr. Chair? Lack of motion. Let me make sure I have the right. Be it ordered that based on the plans, let me see.
Judy, can you point to the right one for us?
Okay. Be it further ordered that the above application be tabled to September 21st, 1993, meeting the planning board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
Second.
It's then moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of that motion, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous vote. The only other thing that I'd like to do is schedule the site walk, if we could. Probably the sooner the better. Is there a specific time, Mr. Petras, for scheduling a site walk for the planning board to look at the lot itself.
Whatever would be convenient to do.
Board, early evening, during the week?
Yeah, we do early evening.
Not on a weekend?
Not on a weekend.
Not on, what day of the week? This isn't 20 questions. Okay. Tuesday? A week from tonight?
Sounds good.
What day are we on now?
17th.
Okay. Tuesday, the 24th.
What time?
Site walk. Fowler Road.
5:30. 6.
5:30.
5:30? Can everybody get there? Okay, 5:30. Can we meet you right, site distance is good, so we must be able to park right there.
Yeah, just at our house.
Okay,
What number?
Yes, what number is it, or what is the house?
231 Fowler.
231 Fowler.
Yep.
Coming from this location, if you're going down Fowler, it would be past Great Pond on the right.
On the right.
Just after Great Pond. It'd be on the right hand side. Am I correct?
Yep.
Okay. Very good. We'll see you then.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, next order of business this evening is the Mailman Service Station. Request by Richard Mailman for site plan review of a change of use to add fuel dispensers located at 1316 Ocean House Road, completeness section 19-2-10. Must be Mr. Mailman.
Good evening, Richard Mailman. A little background. I live in Portland, Maine, with my wife of 24 years. I have lived at this residence for 16 years. I have two children, one entering college this fall, one entering high school this month. I have been in the automobile repair business for 33 years. My father founded the business that I am in. It's called Mailman Service in Portland. I have been the owner of that business for the past 8 years. I currently have a contract with the Murray family to purchase the location next door to Town Hall. To reopen it, I shouldn't say reopen it, it's being used as a service facility now. To continue it as a service facility with the addition of fuel and canopy. Thank you.
Okay. I guess the first issue on the site plan review deals with the issue of completeness. I think before we get to any discussion at all, if I can have any comments, or perhaps Maureen, if you can quickly go down through the checklist with us on the issues, and perhaps that will prompt any questions that the board may have.
This is starting with the submission checklist in the site plan regulations. There's a checklist that's attached, I believe, the last page of the memo before you. Starting with item 5C, there are water and sewer lines depicted on the plans which cross the front lot and serve the rear lot. And I guess they both go together. There was a question raised by the town engineer about whether there's some kind of easement from the front lot to the rear lot that allows those water and sewer lines to cross over. Additionally, the town engineer is concerned that it appears that the sewer lines are ganged and are serving two lots, and he questions whether that is in compliance with our sewer ordinance. Under 6D, again, the town engineer has identified that the parking spaces are not drawn to scale, and that consequently not sure how many parking spaces can be accommodated in the lot. Under number 7, the applicant has shown the setback distances for the proposed canopy, the rear and the side yard setback distances, but not shown the setback distances for the existing building. Under 8A, the ordinance does require that existing physical features within 200 feet of the site are depicted, and some of those features are not shown. Under 10, the method of calculating how many parking spaces are actually going to be required for this use also has not been provided. Under 12A, regarding stormwater, it appears that the applicant is requesting a waiver of the stormwater plan. There are some drainage arrows on the plan. Under 12B, I think I've already addressed that regarding the sewer line serving two lots. Under 12C, the size of the water line is not depicted on the plan. In addition, the board routinely receives a letter from the Portland Water District affirming that there's adequate capacity to serve the use, and that has not been provided. Under 13, there are a significant number of existing trees on the site. Some of those trees are anticipated to remain on the site, but there is no preservation plan to talk about how they're going to be preserved. There are also several evergreen shrubs that are proposed to be planted, but they're not shown where they're supposed to be planted. And I do want to just notify the applicant, as soon as I learned about this, I did speak with the tree warden early last week, and he indicated that little leaf lindens is not on his list, and he would not recommend planting that type of tree. That there's been, they go in really well, but there's a lot of problems once they start to mature. And the applicant is proposing to plant those right now. Under number 14, there's some issue about whether all the lighting which is proposed on the site has actually been depicted on the plan. And on number 15, under signs, there's clearly a proposal to place signage, but there's nothing that talks about where the signs will be placed on the site and what the dimensions and the size of those signs will be. Any questions?
Questions? Comments? Tom?
I guess I'd have to draw an analogy here. There was a day when one could take a 57 Chevy and put it on your front lawn and jack it up and do all the repair work necessary in order to get it running smoothly and on its way. That's certainly no longer the case with a modern automobile. And I'm making an analogy because in my opinion, what we have here in terms of a site plan application, and there's nothing personal in this, it's just a general observation, is more in the tune of a 57 Chevy being fixed on the front lawn than it is with a current professionally prepared application. And I say that in light of the fact that you're in the town center, and the town center has just gone through a planning process and is currently developing ordinance language, and at some point we'll have some design controls or design guidelines, but those are not available. So to a certain extent, we're handcuffed as board members. We don't have the ammunition that we'd like to deal with. More importantly, both as part of the town center report and as part of the comprehensive plan of the town hall is identified as a significant landmark, not only its architectural place quality, but also its place within the town center. As you come along Route 77, the view to town hall is a very strong orienting view and gives a sense of the town center. Something that this community has been struggling with relative to, say, Falmouth, which also had not historically had a sense of a strong town center. So I just want to give you this background so you can understand where you are sitting in terms of the overall development of Cape Elizabeth. And at least in my opinion, your lot is a real hot potato from the standpoint of what message it sends in terms of the type of development that we would hope to encourage in the town center and the opportunities that are available in redeveloping that lot. None of this in any way is an effort to discourage you as a enterprise, as a business person to coming into Cape Elizabeth. We just want to be sure that in coming into Cape Elizabeth that the renovation of this property melds well with all of the work that's gone before in terms of trying to identify the town center as really a pedestrian-friendly location, one that encourages businesses and businesses that are suited to the various uses and quality and character of the town center. And I guess what I, in terms of your application, the concerns I have is exactly those that Maureen has outlined. What is the visual impact going to be from
Route 77 to Town Hall. That view is so important to the town that it was placed on the cover of the Town Center report. I would expect for site plan review to be able to see a prepared view of that, a sketch or something that depicts that view. You provided us with a photocopy of the canopy, but I'd like to see that canopy in place, and I'd like to see a rendering of the proposed improvements to understand what the impacts are on Town Hall. And I'd like to see better delineated drawings, simply so that when you're under construction, you have a good idea of what's going to happen, and so we as board members can clearly decide in site plan review what it is that we're approving and where they will be located on the face of the earth. So I would concur with the list that the planner has provided with us, and I would like to see these items addressed prior to going through any more review of the application.
Thank you. Comments?
Can I make a comment?
Sure.
Okay. First of all, when I first came to the town, I purchased this book, and I tried to address everything that's in this book with Maureen and Mary's assistance. So we're missing something somewhere.
Let me just back up again. I want the point to be very clear. When I made the analogy to a 57 Chevy in a brand new car that has all kinds of pollution control issue items to deal with, I think the application process, particularly in a very sensitive location in the Town Center, particularly where one's talking about developing a business, if it were a shed behind a nursery school, someone who clearly is not going to make an important impact or substantive impact or has not the wherewithal to hire professional engineers or designers, landscape architects or architects, I could understand the situation. But I know what it costs me per hour to go in and have my car serviced, and what you're talking about is a significant business. I know what it costs to have gasoline pumped. We went through the same situation or similar situation with another business just down the street here who wanted to develop an ice cream stand. We had the same concerns when that began, and the applicant did not come back with significantly improved documents which held up the process simply because we didn't know what we were reviewing. And I don't think it's the responsibility of the board, nor is it the responsibility of the town planner, to sit down and develop these plans. I think it's our responsibility to give you our concerns and our comments, and I think it's the town planner's responsibility to let you know what the ordinances are and where things can be found and what the general concerns are in town and those other issues. But I know what a repair manual looks like in a car, and that's not unlike what the process is involved in having a professionally prepared application for this type of project. And I think the town engineer's comments indicate all of those concerns.
Right, the way I understood it, that these were all addressed in the Pond Cove subdivision that was passed by the planning board for Pond Cove Associates, addressing all these water lines in 1988 in reference to the back lot, the sewer lines, and the water lines. This has already been passed by this board, or maybe you're not your members, but by the planning board.
I don't have a clue as to what you're talking about.
Yeah, I think you're referring to the fact that this lot is lot number 4 in the small subdivision of the properties on that corner, which that subdivision itself was approved in 1988, I believe. I think the point that this board is we're reviewing what the site plan review for changes on one site. Lot number 4, I think.
Lot number 3. Number 4 would be the back lot.
Okay. What's wrong? Number 3. I think that the comments made on from the town engineer's letter are issues that all need to be resolved on the plan that was presented to us. It looks like you have reworked an original Owen Haskell plan into your own.
That's correct.
I guess I'll keep my comments short because I want to let the other board members speak. one of the key things for me as one board member is that the items aren't drawn to scale. And so when they're not drawn to scale, I don't know what you're really doing because they don't fit. In other words, your canopy on plan number one isn't in the same location as it is on plan number two, and it's not in the same location as it is with the Portland Pump Company's diagram. So we get three different locations of your canopy. Well, that's not the job of the planning board to put that in the right place. It's not the job of the planner to put it in the right place. It's the applicant's responsibility to make sure that they're appropriately represented. The parking is a key issue. If you extend those lines to scale, you have a couple of that cross over each other. So
my understanding, pardon me, was on the parking was that as long as I denoted where I plan to park, okay. So because this book here requests that new businesses move their vehicles away from the street. So what I was trying to denote is this is where the cars would be parked. Mm-hmm. Rather than whether it's to scale as far as the parking lots or the parking spaces are to scale.
I think is what the board is telling you is that as a matter of completeness, we're requesting that the plans be presented to us drawn to scale so that we can see where those changes are in addition to where the parking is going from a health and safety issue. Is it safe to put that many there? I'll stop my comments and go back to the board members at this time. Other comments?
I have the feeling I'm the minority on the board when I say this, but I agree with everything Mr. Emery said about the significance of the parcel and the inadequacy of the plans and the town engineer's comments. But believe it or not, I don't have that many issues with completeness on this project. It's the kind of thing I look down and see you have to have the utilities on here. I see them on here. They don't seem very adequate, but they're on here. I know I usually approach completeness different than other board members, but I would just like to put my 10 cents worth in. I definitely agree with Mr. Emery that this plan needs a professional to do it. I don't disagree that anything he indicated or other board members have indicated need to be on here. I simply personally would have a problem differentiating completeness from adequacy if we start saying you've got parking spaces on here but they're not to scale. You start crossing a fine line. So for what it's worth, that's my opinion. I would call it complete.
Yeah, and I appreciate your comments. You always bring us back into focus when it comes to, or quite often you bring us back to focus on completeness issues. And we do, evidently both Tom and I have looked at this and said, there's a plan that's very difficult even to work with as planners. But at the same point, yes, checklist by checklist item, some of those items are complete. I guess my question to you, do you feel that through the checklist here of the partials, starting with 5C, and down through that list, do you concur with those that those are partial, or do you find that what is submitted for location of easements, for instance, do you think that that's complete?
I understand what you're saying. I think it's very hard to say something's partially complete. The bottom line is, for completeness, you call something complete or not. I understand exactly why Maureen said that. I also know that this board and other boards operate on the assumption that the ordinance says one thing, that usually the application or checklist material says something else, usually more detailed or getting closer to what we want. And then there's the third standard that even though these two say this, the board is always looking for this particular detail as well. In fairness to applicants, I don't know that they can always get all that information. Fairness to the planner, I think they're often told that information and don't want to deal with it either. I don't know what the situation is here. I will not presume to say what it is. I try to be consistent on this approach, and there was snickering here when I tried to get the utility information on the last one in the public record. I like to have the information to know it's here, even if it's really woefully inadequate. And I think if we send this gentleman back and say he's incomplete, I would feel very uncomfortable with other completeness decisions we've made. I, again, don't mind being in the minority either, though.
No, I think what I'd like to see is if we could review the completeness checklist.
Would you like me to do that?
If you could, and have feedback from the, I'm trying to reach a consensus here. Believe it or not, this perhaps will save you some time.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Before we get into the detail of this, right, could I just make a comment with respect,
sure,
to Judy's comment? I respect Judy's opinion, and I think she is being extremely fair. And I think it's, her comments are consistent with the other applications we've received tonight, although they're not site plan applications. The only concern I have is I have a very good memory of the process we're already involved in and had gone through for a long time with the property next door. And I want the applicant to understand, regardless of what the decision is on completeness tonight, in my opinion, there's an awful lot of work left to do on these plans, and I would strongly recommend that you retain the services of a professional in order to prepare the plans for you. I can't say it any stronger than that, because what we've heard after, and I'm doing this defensively because I know the council's after certain issues that the board reviews and other things, but it is not the responsibility of this board to walk applicants through the process, and particularly in complex projects like the one that you have. And I wouldn't have in my own opinion, I wouldn't allow a positive vote for completeness to indicate that the plans are, gee, they're great, but I'll draw these lines a little better. To me, it's a much greater issue, and this is a parcel that in my work as a representative of the planning board on the town center committee, and having been involved in this property, the adjacent property, is very much of a concern to me as a board member.
Can I speak on that?
Certainly, go ahead.
The thing is that I kind of think that if you're coming into a community, that you should approach the community to see what they would like to see. And I think I came to this community with that approach. And I think that's the best way to work any particular business when you're trying to improve a location to fit into the community. And you say you don't feel that the people that represent the town should lead you through your application for what you want to do at a particular location. Well, I figure these are the people that the town have hired to do this particular job, and these are the people that people like myself should depend on to do the right job. And I that's the way I feel, is that I try to approach this in a meaningful way for the betterment of the community, not for the betterment of myself.
I think that's a good approach. The only comment I would have is that we have had feedback from other applicants that we're either holding them up in the process when we made it very clear from the very beginning, and I think the ordinance makes it clear that there are some issues that certainly the DEP makes it clear that there are certain issues that require and they strongly suggest retaining professional assistance. And I guess that's where I'll end. I think what I'm describing is a planner or a staff leading you through the process versus what you're considering to be that, probably two different things one way or the other, but I think I've said enough.
What I'd like to do is simply start down through the list as quickly as we can, starting with 5C, or let Judy go down through here, and I'd like the feedback from the other board members as well as to some type of consensus. Do we feel that that item is complete? I mean, not is it adequate?
Mm-hmm.
Not is it technically correct? But is it complete enough to proceed with this application for site plan review?
Before I say anything again, I would like to really support what Mr. Emery said. I have no disagreement with what you're saying. I think it's an extremely important parcel, and I also am not telling the board I'm right on this. I think this is one of those close calls again, and I'm leaning toward completeness. So, to go on, I would say on 5C, which indicates location of easements, I did not see any evidence in here that there are, in fact, easements. I think there's a good chance there may be. If they're not, there should be. but since I don't know, I'm not convinced they should be on the plans right now.
The key, and maybe Maureen can help me there, is that for me, the drainage easement to the onto the town property, it's proposing using the drainage onto this property from that property, and I don't see any notation of easement.
That's an existing pattern, is that correct?
That's correct.
And do we have evidence that there is an existing easement?
Not that I know of.
So that's why I can't see as an issue of completeness. If there is one, we find out, it should be on the plan. Perhaps this is the time to negotiate an easement, but I don't know how we could call him accountable for having it on a plan right now if it may not exist, and if the town can't tell us if it exists right tonight.
I was asked to show a water flow on to you folks, and that is on there.
I saw that.
And because I was told that you're going to want to know where the water does go, that's where it does go.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't say anything that I was going to have to put a catch basin in, whether they were going to require that. They wanted to know where the water actually was going. So I took the people that are running the property now, and I sat down and talked with them. You can stand on the property, you can see the flow pattern of the water as it comes down across the lot and feeds this side and comes right to your backside. And
okay, I don't want to go into detail. I think there's a feedback from the board as to completeness of that item. Guess not.
I'll go on.
Okay, fine.
Item 60, proposed parking areas. The applicant is showing proposed parking areas. I agree that they're very inadequate for any number of reasons, but there are some on the plan. Item 7, the building setback, sideline, and rear yard distances. There's been an effort to indicate those for the new canopy structure proposed. I hate getting into these issues where there's an existing building and if we would hold somebody up because there's not an actual setback distance recorded on the plan. I guess I would assume that I could scale it out. If that's not the case, this is more evidence that this really needs to be reworked, but I would still consider that complete. 8A, the existing physical features on site and within 200 feet of the site. I assume we're caught up mainly on the 200 feet of the site, and I know we have not consistently applied that as a completeness standard. We just dealt with that this evening, didn't we? On the actually, that wasn't site plan. I take that back. But I do remember other times saying these plans have to be revised. You don't have the names of the owners across the street or the driveway, so forth. I guess I felt that was consistent. Item 10, parking.
Wait, before you go on, we've jumped down through a couple. Any
okay.
comments from the board? Mark?
Yes, on the question on number 10, parallels 6D, because if the parking spaces are not calculated nor shown to scale, we don't know, we have no way from looking at the materials submitted whether there are 20 parking spaces or 50 parking spaces on the site, which is which although it would be complete because it has shown parking spaces, I don't think that the intent of the ordinance is just to show some parking spaces, but to show how many parking spaces there will be in the development when completed, and I think that's something we need to know.
May I comment on that?
Yes, please.
I think you'll see that I have the number on the blueprint of the amount of parking spaces and how I came to that conclusion. Okay, the parking spaces are to be 10 by 19. I agree with you that they might not be to scale on this particular drawing, as and I want to indicate again, I was trying to show where I would like the vehicles parked in reference to keeping them away from the front of the building, away from 77, so that people had a clear view of Town Hall coming either way, or the Murray Building without interference with cars being parked out front, as they are now. If you take and you count up the amount of parking spaces I'm proposing versus the square footage of the building, that falls in code to the town of Cape Elizabeth. I don't know what the amount of parking spaces in my own head at this particular moment that is required for the square footage of the building, but when it was figured, the parking spaces that are showing, it more than adequately covers what the town of Cape Elizabeth is asking for the square footage of the building.
I just noticed now that it does say 15 cars on the plan, and the graphic count on the plan is 15 spaces. Is that what you're proposing, 15 spaces?
Yes, sir. Whatever the count of the marked out is. And I agree with you that, you know, it isn't a scale. The one that I was concerned about being the scale as close as possible is the first drawing showing the canopy. The other drawings were just to show where the canopy is located in reference to other things that were taking place as far as parking and as far as shrubs and sewer and water and stormwater movement. Okay, now you had said that somebody had made the comment about the canopy appears in three different locations from what was presented to you. The plan that would be used is the top plan is in reference to the canopy because that has all the setbacks. And there was one setback that wasn't denoted that in reference to the building and the canopy, what the